Nagappa sir, please start the program.
Yeah. Thank you. Good evening all. So, on behalf of Karnataka Veterinary Animal and Fishery Science University, I welcome all the participants of this particular webinar, national webinar on zoonosis, which is being organized on the occasion of just to start with, let us start the session with
no problem. Thank you.
For a man to be truly suited to the profession or practice of medicine, he must be possessed of the natural disposition and other necessary things that are required for it. So always holy things are left to the holy man, and ultimately the profane or the ones who have the interest in the kind, so that the mysteries of the science are revealed to the mankind. With this message from the Hippocrates, let me start this webinar on zoonosis. We are on the third day of zoonosis week, and today with us we have the distinguished guest from our but sir Dilip Kumar sir, who is going to address us, and followed by that we have an eminent speaker in the area of veterinary public health, Dr. H. P. Barbadesar. Just to begin with, now may I request Professor Dilip Kumar sir, Dean Veterinary College Bidar, to please address the participants. Dilip sir, please.
Thank you, Dr. Nagappa. Good evening, everybody. Karnataka Veterinary Animal and Fishery Sciences University, Bidar's Constituent Veterinary College, Hassan Veterinary College, is celebrating the World Zoonosis Day of the year 2020. And the Zoonosis Week from 1st to 7th July has been scheduled. And the exact Zoonosis Day happens to be on the 6th July of this month. So it is very nice to hear that so many discussions are going on since from the 1st July, and I'm sure definitely all are getting benefited out of that. So today's our respected speaker is Dr. S.B. Barbude, Principal Scientist, ICR, NRCM, Hyderabad, and also the organizers who have taken the pain in organizing all these events, participants, and students of this particular webinar. Many organizations and institutions have shifted the learning to the online tools. Deliberations, discussions nowadays are happening only on online. As you are all aware, the pandemic COVID-19 has paralyzed the very educational component. So as so many norms are there, maintaining social distance, avoiding the crowding, in this situation, it is the only tool that is available for us. We can reach to the far off people from this particular media. In this direction, the organizers' efforts for this particular webinar can be very well appreciated. So this being an open platform to share the resources and also expertise to the stakeholders. I am happy to learn that today's talk will be presented by Dr. Barbude, S.B. Barbude, Principal Scientist of ICR NRCM Hyderabad, who is an eminent scientist. He is well known for his extensive work and expertise on listeria. It is really a matter of joy to listen to his views about foodborne zoonosis in India. Since most of the population in India is living in the rural area, approximately 70% of the population happens to live in the rural areas of our country. The livestock, their daily needs and the regular touch with the livestock around the day make them prone for the foodborne diseases. So the prevalence and distribution, as well as the transmission pattern of these foodborne diseases, are exaggerated by the influence of both human and environmental factors. In fact, such diseases warrant human public health for appropriate surveillance, so that proper measures should be taken by the government to check their transmission. So there is a famous saying from Nelson Mandela regarding the education. Education is the most powerful weapon which can be used to change the world. There is one more proverb regarding the education. Education is the vaccine for violence. To avoid the violence, we have to educate the people. And one more regarding the educational intensity proverb is that if you are planning for a year, you just sow a rice. If you are planning for a decade, you plant trees. If you are planning for a lifetime, you educate the people.
Abdul.
Yes, sir.
The importance of the education. During this situation of COVID-19, the organizing webinars is a very important thing to change the educational facet. So from the chalkpiece, blackboard, the classroom teaching to this open air teaching creates an environment and it will try to cater the needs of the student community. Unsafe food still costs very high for the India, approximately $15 billion annually, even though it has almost halved from 20.
Abdul, again, there is a cut.
Underlying the unnecessary high economic burden caused by the foodborne diseases. Animal source foods estimated to account around 21% of India's foodborne diseases burden. It accounts for around 59% in China. A recent study on the food safety in developing countries, research gaps, opportunities has found 70% of the foodborne diseases in India are attributed to the consumption of animal source foods such as livestock products and aquatic foods. Human coexist in a complex interdependent relationship with the companion, production and wild animals which depend on for our food. The livelihood and well-being as well as the environments we live work in together. The interface between the human, animals and the environment we share can also be a source of disease impacting the public health and social and economic well-being of the world population. The World Health Organization, WHO, definition of human disease is...
Dilip sir, keep the phone in front, sir. Inakalpa kai mundu ittoli, sir. So that your face is clear.
Any disease, infection, that can be transmitted from the vertebrate animals to human. So animals play an essential role in maintaining zoonotic infections in nature. Zoonosis may be, as we all know that, maybe because of bacteria, virus, or a parasite, may involve unconventional agents as well as. Being the public health problem, many major zoonotic diseases prevent the efficient production of the food of animal origin, create an obstacle for the international trade in the animal products. Emerging zoonotic diseases can be evolved. Diseases most particularly in the developing nations or maybe have been obscured in the past and now expanding rapidly the new geographic areas. The host or vector ranges due to their changing ecology, such as scrub typhus, cutaneous leishmaniasis, Japanese encephalitis. Another important problem we face today is antimicrobial resistance in the human pathogens. It's a major health problem threat, which is particularly impacted by the use of antibiotics in animal husbandry and agriculture sector. Cross-sectorial collaboration is a key understanding and managing public health.
Abdul.
Global health security. In the developed countries, there are increasing demands for consumers for food of animal origin, which is free from pathogens and chemical residues. Additionally, growing in organic, outdoor, and aquaculture farming will likely present higher residue risk for infection in developing countries like ours, India. The problem of foodborne diseases are compounded by socio-economic economic factors like illiteracy, poverty, poor sanitization, overcrowding, proximity to the animals, and lack of clean drinking water as well, the socio-cultural practices of food sourcing and consumption. India, along with the other countries, has demonstrated that better health and commercial outcomes are possible with the joint involvement of the public agencies, business, and consumers in food safety. Food Safety and Standard Authority of India has taken a series of measures, including stringent packaging, labeling norms, and regulation of restaurants, street foods, as well as inspection and sampling of the food products to ensure the good quality of food in India. Coming to today's topic, the experiential translation learned from the listeriosis, which is very much apt at the present situation. Listeriosis is an infection and fatal disease of animals, birds, fish, crustaceans, and humans. It is an important foodborne disease. This is caused by the Listeria monocytogenes, an intracellular pathogen with a unique potentiality to spread from cell to cell, thereby crossing the blood-brain barrier, the intestinal barrier, as well as the placental barrier. The organism possesses virulence factors that help to infect the host and evade the host immunity machinery. The disease occurrence is sporadic though, but it is present throughout the world. It can cause severe damage during an outbreak. On this occasion, I wholeheartedly congratulate the speaker, the alumni of Hassan Veterinary College, organizers who have taken all their pain in organizing this webinar, and I wish them all a grand success. And today's speaker, being a quite reputed, experienced person from the reputed institute, I thank him for the today's presentation he is going to present in future. So it will definitely benefit all the people who are participating in the webinar. Lastly, in the phase of pandemic COVID-19, I would like to say to all of you, stay safe in Jai Karnataka.
Thank you, sir. That was a fantastic elaboration. Probably there is nothing left for me to sum up. We have talked about human, animal, and ecosystem interface. You talked about AMR, and you talked about the speaker also. So that has lessened my burden. So we are 13 minutes past from our schedule now. So without taking much time, I wholeheartedly welcome all the deans, directors, the eminent professionals, to the students to this webinar. So before I hand over the virtual platform to Dr. Barbude sir, so let me introduce him very briefly, because it is impossible to describe him or to talk about him in a minute or two. So those who are interested, please log on to the NRCM website and you will come to know his biodata. So there is a saying that, so I can quote that, a mind that never stops in public health thinking is Dr. Barbude sir. So if you see his biodata, after his graduation from the Nagpur Veterinary College and the doctoral from the prestigious Indian Veterinary Research Institute, he has gathered many awards and laurels. So he is a recipient of JRF, DPSRF, and so many awards, to the International Overseas Fellowship Award from the EDC, he is a recipient of these things. He is the instrumental in establishing the Indo-German collaboration for the listeriosis, the studies on listeriosis, the translational center. And he is a recognized faculty member in various universities. To name few of them, he is the expert in the for the Goa University, for Chhattisgarh University, likewise many universities. And his role internationally, now he has been recognized as a eminent expert for listeriosis. And the ISOPOL, when we talk about if this is what is the international advisory committee that deals with the problems on listeriosis, he has been the member of international advisory committees on several occasions in several countries. and he himself has organized one such event in Goa. He is the member of joint FAO WHO expert committee on microbial risk assessment, that too ready to eat type of foods pertaining to Listeria monocytogenes. Sir has published over several papers, 90 international papers, 44 national papers. He has contributed in the form of book or chapter altogether 21. He has one patent, and his work that revolves around listeriosis. So he is the project coordinator of Center for Excellence, sponsored by Biotechnology Department of Biotechnology. He has developed the listeria and other organism, and he has developed the listeria culture database, so which is unique in India. And he has developed several molecular techniques for listeria, coxiella, and likewise other zoonotic pathogens. So he is closely associated with the Justus Liebig University, Gießen, Germany. So there is an Indo-German consortium that Dr. Barbudey leads. So this is in very brief, because we want to participants are more interested in listening what sir says. And the youngsters, if you see, he is an inspiration to the those aspiring students who are meritorious students, and for young faculty like me, because if you see his awards starting from the this fellow of National Academy of Veterinary Sciences, like several such award, the DBT, CSIR, like that. And if you talk about the contributions, they are very immense. So more than 90 international publications, means you can just think of. So with this, without taking much time, now may I request the eminent public health veterinarian, Dr. S.P. Barbudey sir, to please address the participants. Please, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Narappa. Respected Dean Dr. Dilip Kumar sir, who has happened to be my senior at IVRI. My mentor, Dr. Malik sir, is online. Dr. Nagappa, all the faculty from the Karnataka Veterinary and Animal Sciences University. At the outset, I thank you all for giving me this opportunity to be to present this our work actually here. So maximum part of my work actually whatever we have done over the years, that I want to share with all of you. And then later first we'll talk about the mainly the zoonosis in India. Then latter part, actually, what is the work we have done in listeriosis as in translation mode in India, and how we, from the pathogen which was lesser known in India, how it has become a masterpiece of work in India actually, and many groups we are working in India. Dr. Nagappa, you can hear me properly? Hello?
Yes, sir, definitely. Okay.
So the topic given by the organizers is the foodborne zoonosis in India. Experiential translations learned from listeriosis. So I will, before I talk about listeriosis, let me take you a little about zoonosis. This is very famous slide which must have seen many students, and the faculty must have seen about the zoonosis, that the total human pathogens, they are categorized up to 1415. Out of that, around 61% they are constitute the zoonotic infections, and this is the distribution among viruses, bacteria, fungi, and protozoa, and helminths. Maximum you see figure, fungus and helminths, they constitute a major area of these pathogens. So again, this, you know, zoonosis actually, if you consider them, there are different causes, and but as far as our country is concerned, we are massively, this is reported massively underreported in any reporting you see. If you talk of any of the disease actually, you will see lesser the reports. Then, of course, they cause significant human morbidity and mortality. Many diseases, if you think of zoonotic TB or that of brucellosis or salmonella or maybe E. coli diarrhea or complementariasis, many type of foodborne infections actually. They are actually significant morbidity and mortality also, particularly rotavirus and other viral infections also. Then, of course, they impose, being zoonoses, they impose dual burden on animals as well as humans also. Then some of the ancient diseases also actually they are eradicated from wealthy countries, but still we face problem in India. Then control at source when feasible is highly cost effective, but still we are losing because we have seen this control of COVID definitely in their system, diagnosis and other things also. Of course, they pose a potential of global threat, many of particularly foodborne infections when you are exporting food. So that also forms actually part of the our global threat. So if you see these zoonoses actually in low-income countries like African or maybe South Asian or the other countries, 10% of the total dalits, they are lost because of only zoonoses. And in high-income countries like European and some African countries, it is still low because they are having diagnosing other facilities and healthcare facilities, just 0.02%. So you can see the infectious disease burden in the low-income countries. This is very, very important. So now, this is also a very famous slide, if you must have seen earlier also. Burden of foodborne diseases is substantial. And every year, foodborne diseases, they cause around almost 10 million people. One in 10 people, you fall ill because of the foodborne infections. Total 33 million healthy victims are lost. So if you consider the hospital reported deaths or reported deaths, around 4,20,000 figure, maybe this is old figure, but it may cross now 5 lakh also, more than 5 lakhs. And children amount for more than 1/3 of the deaths from these foodborne diseases. So that's actually our children, particularly age less than 5 years of age, they are more vulnerable for such infection. So just I want to narrate actually, you must have heard in newspaper and also literature also, there was one massive outbreak of enterohemorrhagic E. coli in Germany. 2011, and you know this cause was this sprout. There is sprout they are selling the market. So actually, this outbreak particularly more than 3,000 people fall ill with acute gastroenteritis, and 855 of them developed hematic uremic syndrome, and there were around 55 deaths. So that caused the havoc in particularly in Germany and other European, Austria and other countries also. Then another event you must have read in newspaper and every literature also, listeriosis massive outbreak in South Africa very recently. I think January 2017 to July 2018, where more than 1,060 laboratory confirmed cases with 216 deaths, and in processed meat, ready to eat processed meat was actually contaminated with some facility which was responsible actually. And those countries never knew that in Africa such an outbreak will occur. So that has become one of the biggest outbreak of listeriosis in the history of World Health Organization. Third event I will just narrate is Coxsella outbreak in Netherlands. You must have also seen the literature on this particular faculty. Between 2007 to 10, there was a very big outbreak of Coxsella. And after more than 2,200 confirmed cases of the disease, the U.S. government has slaughtered more than 50,000 dairies in almost more than 400 farms. So, transmitted from actually contaminated goat, and you know it is also one of the cause of mastitis also, and this abortions in India also you are reported. So, this is one event. Now, we are fighting with the COVID. There is one paper. What they say is, this is the first, maybe there are conflicting reports whether it is transmitted to food or not, but mechanical transmission of this is possible. So, first respiratory transmitted foodborne outbreak. Because a lot of virus actually, they are, you know, all these originated from the seafood market in Wuhan, China. So, what they say is the first respiratory infection transmit foodborne outbreak. This is talked about COVID. So, these are the events. This much event actually, world global event is enough to tell you what is the problem of the foodborne viruses worldwide. And every time the newspapers also, they will have all the newspaper they report different type of upper viral diseases, food poisoning, combination reporting outbreak in India. So many reports are coming in newspaper also, maybe midday meal or other things or messages or somewhere actually some always alternative kind of report in the newspaper about the foodborne diseases. So what is how they transmit actually? Everybody knows actually how the foodborne, particularly if you go in the hospital also, as far as these OPD cases are concerned, you will find 50% more than 50% cases some stomach upset or some diarrhea or some nausea, some cases actually. So if you are not doing details of all the cases in India because of the caseload, but you will find majority of the transmitted to food or water. Then if you consider the transmission, so animal feed, environment, so many food animals, maybe other things if you are not processing properly, or even if you see the not only animal oriented food, even these vegetables, particularly these are harvested from these sewage areas, or even the fruits, they are not passing properly. Even there are many outbreaks of these infections through consumption of fruits also. Like there was a big outbreak of listeriosis in Canada because of the apples or this caramel, that is kharbuza, what we call in actually muskmelon. So like that also, sometimes this putting of the apple, they were also responsible for the outbreak. So any type of food actually, maybe plant origin or animal origin or plant derived product, if you are not processing properly, not packing properly, or not handled in the hygienic manner, or any type of ready to feed foods which are not stored properly or not handled properly, can cause foodborne infection. So there is no, even if you are now they are telling wash your hand, if you are not washing your hand also before eating any type of food, you may get some type of food poisoning. So this is also actually one report that was published in 2012 by International Livestock Research Institute. So they categorize the topmost priority zoonoses. And I think you must have seen this list also. There are 13 zoonoses they have listed, which is out of 56 diseases they have studied. And unfortunately, most of these diseases, they are highly prevalent in our conditions in India. Particularly if you see cysticercosis, or zoonotic tuberculosis, brucellosis, echinococcosis, toxoplasmosis, Q fever, anthrax, hepatitis C, all actually these are the constitute from transmission through food particularly. So we are facing a lot of problems actually, maybe mortality among the low strata of the population with infections. And India ranks among the top 20 countries, above the African countries also. So this is actually not a good thing for our country. So now I will just tell you about some of the very, very important foodborne infections. You need not to go in detail, but just which are very prevalent before I talk about listeriosis much about. So campylobacteriosis, so this is a disease actually highly reported. Many reports are there in India from almost all the states. If you see the published literature from Kashmir, to from Gujarat, from Karnataka, from Maharashtra, from Tamil Nadu, everywhere they have published this, many reports about, and very high incidence. And you must remember that this is one of the cause of, this is isolated from meat and processed foods and poultry pieces, so many sources. And you may be knowing this is one of the leading cause of Guillain-Barré syndrome, besides the other gastroenteritis and other symptoms. So many of these, then hepatitis, gastritis, so many type of syndromes, these are the campylobacter species are responsible. And this is one of the highly prevalent species, pathogen in India. And contamination, consumption of contaminated food or water, or even this contaminated, the animal is infected. Even person to person spread if you are not handling properly. So that is also been reported in this literature. Then coming to Q fever, this is also the most contagious, and it is one of the cause of mastitis, and also the spontaneous abortions. Our own studies, we have a lot of things we have published in here also from IVRI, Dr. Malik sir's group. We are also working in that institute also. So many reports in from animals, humans, also from foods of animal origin. We have reported this pathogen in India. Transmission actually, abortion material, if you are not handling properly, then even milk actually, if it is not properly, the animal is infected, it can be excreted in milk also. In such cases also, this can transmit even aerosols and dust and environment. And my studies on among slaughterhouse workers, is highly prevalent infection in the abattoir-associated persons through occupational exposure. So this is very, very common in India also. Then zoonotic tuberculosis, you need no emphasis because you know every 3 minutes in India, two persons die because of tuberculosis. And the old thing that their Mycobacterium tuberculosis, they were telling much prevalent, but now recent studies from India, many laboratories they are working now, they are telling Mycobacterium bovis is more prevalent than Mycobacterium tuberculosis in human cases. and you know this different times of, and even from India also now intestinal tuberculosis, there are cases now, because if you eat the raw milk or other products, actually even meat, actually semi cooked meat, or some tribal populations, actually they are reporting even extra pulmonary TB, what we call it actually. So this is one of the highest prevalent. Even contaminated water, even rodents, actually they can transmit in many type of non tuberculous bacteria also. So very difficult to diagnose because of the serological this cross reactions. That's why now only molecular tests are, they are used for diagnosing tuberculosis. But it is very, very highly prevalent, and we are losing more than 5 lakh people every year because of this infection. So if you see boy tuberculosis, this is the data actually. It is, they are telling up to 16% in cattle and up to 65% buffaloes they are reported, and 10% of the human TB are caused by Mycobacterium bovis. But now research studies, they are telling more and more cases of Mycobacterium bovis in case of human beings also. So then coming to foodborne viral infections, this is much neglected area actually. So many type of viruses actually they are actually unlike bacteria, they do not multiply in food, but and fewer infectious particles are sufficient to cause this infection and produce illness. And you will find any type of food actually, even vegetables which are grown on sewage or fecal contamination actually, infected food handlers or other things actually, they are three major routes actually where from the viral contamination comes. So and there is no systematic surveillance of foodborne viral diseases. Very few labs in India, they look for actually viral infections, India foodborne, particularly foodborne viral infections. So very, very, very high incidence in among the global data also. This is a lot of infections, foodborne infections or foodborne viral infections they are prevalent. So if you consider norovirus actually, particularly norovirus is actually, and low variant infectious dose. So from India also, norovirus gastroenteritis number 4 in southern India, they are reported actually. And this is the first report of norovirus disease, and very, very high incidence, around 11% of norovirus infection. So particularly these children less than 5 years of age, they will have some diarrhea and watery diarrhea or something. So very difficult to diagnose also. They will, sometimes they will recover as such also. So nobody goes for the detailed investigation. That's why the true prevalence are true, is incidence are true, is extent, what extent it is prevalent in India, we don't know about the disease. Then rotavirus is very much established in India, and so many type of rotavirus which age A to H they are, and different type of genotypes they are also prevalent. Our colleagues work from Northeast and also from IVRI, they are showing different disease highly prevalent in India. And less than 5 years of age, if you see the people, more than 5 lakh children, they get infected every year because of this. And it's highly prevalent in piglets and also the young animals, particularly maybe cattle, buffalo, or goats, yeah, all these species actually. And a lot of cases in humans also, this because of this rotavirus. Then rotavirus, viral hepatitis, there are A, B, C, D, E, but hepatitis A and hepatitis E, they are very much transmitted through actually food, any type of food or infected contaminated water. Lot of cases you will find in India also. And hepatitis E particularly now in from pigs, human strains actually, genotype, they are reported from India also. And this is also very, very common disease in India. Then coming to toxoplasmosis, this also highly underreported. And some studies at National Institute of Animal Biotechnology in Hyderabad, they have now studied this toxoplasma, and they found very, very high incidence, particularly antibiotic in aquaculture exposed person as well as the control population also. So this is one of, and you know, you may be aware that this toxoplasmosis transmitted to this cat particularly, very much detrimental for the pregnant women. It can transmit through their fecal sample pieces of these kittens or something. So this is very, very important, but less studied in India. Then cysticercosis, this is very, very, again, very important disease. And if you see neurocysticercosis, this is, there is a center of excellence in AIIMS, Delhi. Their data says actually, the around 30% of the epilepsy cases in India these are responsive because of the neurocysticercosis. The data may not be available actually, but because not many people are studying on these infections, so they always go underestimated or underreported. So this is very important, cysticercosis. So active epilepsy and other things, this is very common. And UCR has studied actually, they found very, very high incidence of this cysticercosis, particularly this epilepsy cases. I told 30% of the epilepsy cases, they are because of the neurocysticercosis in India. Then another infection is echinococcosis. Lot of cases actually, in Nagpur area itself, many hospitals, they operate many cases of this cyst, hydatidiform cyst actually, every year actually. So transmitted through the pieces of dogs or cats or even contaminated sheep, this fecal contamination or so. This is very common, but also underestimated and underreported in that condition. So if you see this, I put one slide from this weekly outbreak from IDSP, Integrated Disease Surveillance Program. This is actually 24th February to 1st March of 2020. If you see here, outbreaks that 1 week, we'll find around 10 to 15 outbreaks because of food poisoning. If you see, I cannot give it more clear, but more than 10 outbreaks of foodborne illnesses within a week in 24 February to 1st March of 2020. See, so much this one. So we find in the rainy season particularly, again, it will be more than 20 outbreaks in a single week. They are reporting from the NCDC New Delhi, there is under that IDSP. So this is actually the scale of this food poisoning or foodborne outbreak in case of condition. So coming to this, what work actually, literally, that is actually experience, whatever experience, what how we have studied actually. So this is one slide actually, which summarizes the genus Listeria. So if you see the books actually, which are available in veterinary college library, you will find only 6 species they are mentioning. Listeria, monocytogenous Listeria, Ivanova, Inakua, Belsimeri, Siligeri, and Gray. But now, as in today, we have more 20 species of Listeria, 20 species. So the students who are listening, so if you write any question, actually, if you don't mention 6 species, now it is 20 species of Listeria. So it is, you know, it is ubiquitous, and everywhere you find it. Vegetation, soil, even water, our studies, I will tell you later also from which sources. We have the collection from the around 42 sources of different sources from India. And it is, can tolerate pH, 4 pH it can grow, or 5 pH, and it can grow up to 9.5 also. Even it can grow at 5 degrees Celsius, it can grow up to 45 degrees Celsius also. Even up to 10 to 15% of salt, this bacteria can grow. And transmission is mainly through contaminated food, maybe contaminated milk, water, even vegetables, but in food, it can transmit in kind of isolation, even different type of leafy vegetables, even actually brings then again type of fruits, different type of fruits also. And it is a factor to interest and all types of tissues are important. Right from brain to intestine, everywhere actually. And in humans particularly, it causes sepsis, meningitis, granulomatous, infantiseptic, and so many other conditions, abortions, encephalitis also. And out of these 20 species now, only 2 species, Listeria monocytogenous and Listeria ivanova, are the species which are pathogenic for humans and animals. Other species, there are reports about Inakua, Belsimeri, and Gray, or Siligeri has one or two reports. But other species which are isolated recently, they don't have any human infection reported from those species. So as far as humans are concerned, for healthy adults, this can be mainly diarrhea and fever can cause. So we call it a disease of the particularly immunocompromised individuals. And for pregnant women, particularly fever, diarrhea, abortion, and stillbirth, and newborns, sepsis, pneumonia, meningitis. And in case of pregnant women, if you see the literature again, more than 50% of the cases in literature will be seen because of the pregnant women only. And newborn, particularly born with sepsis, and the outcome will be fatal. And you will find in the organ, liver, skin, cerebral and blood, and most cases being hospitalized, 91% around hospitalized rate is there in case of this cases. So this is one slide will tell you very important. So it was isolated in 1929, but it was recognized as an emerging pathogen in 1986 only by WHO. And if you see the microbiology journal, food microbiology particularly, 1986 to around up to 1995,
75% of the budget of WHO was given to only to work on listeria. So much problem in Europe and America, so many outbreaks, hundreds of outbreaks, and most striking feature of this pathogen is this case fatality rate, 20 to 30%. If you consider E. coli, Salmonella, if you are 100 people are affected, hardly one or two may die, all may survive. But in case of listeriosis, if 100 people are affected, 20 to 30% have to die. So much is the fatality rate, case fatality rate in this pathogen. That's why in Europe and America, this is highly notifiable disease. And even in a food factory or a food processing unit, if they find this bacteria in the soil also in the premises of the factory has to be closed overnight. So much stringent regulations are there in Europe. So I told about 90% over 90% hospitalization rate. Then perinatal and neonatal mortality is much higher actually. Up to 63% they are reported. And 50% case fatality in newborns actually. So one of the one outbreak in, I think 1992 in France, 279 people were there affected, particularly mainly children and pregnant women. Out of that, more than 50% case fatality rate was reported in that case also. And the economic costs are very, very high because this medical cost as well as the whenever any batch of the food is affected, there are these recalls. So that also is causing much in the particular European countries. Now coming to the transmission, I told about mainly this transmission is always through food and any type of food, you name it, fish, then milk or meat, any type of meat, even raw vegetables, fruits, even sewage. Many, there are many sources actually which can, and population at risk is mainly the persons with the immunocompromised nature actually, or T-cell, where the T-cell immunity is lower. For example, pregnant women or newborn children or persons with corticosteroid therapy or any having transplantation or any HIV patients, there are more and more cases of the listeriosis. And this is the particular pathogenesis is mediated through mainly new different type of viral factor. And one thing must be borne in mind that this pathogen can transmit all the three barriers like blood-brain barrier, intestinal barrier and placental barrier. That means it can cause encephalitis, it can cause diarrhea or gastroenteritis, or it can cause abortion and other things also. Even now, new literature is coming. This is one of the leading cause of pneumonia. And several cases, outbreaks of gastroenteritis, also they were attributed to listeria. We never look for these pathogens actually, or their role, or particular listeria in our country also, other countries also. So, and then it can cause abscesses, it can cause septicemia. So any type of things, it can show all type of barriers and from nail to your hairs actually, any of the organs actually, it can affect even skin infections in veterinarians, they have been reported. So, and different type of pathogenic factors, I will not go in detail of the pathogenic factors about this, but there in Indian population, like this Indian astronauts also we have seen, I will discuss that also about little about this. And we have actually clubbed actually, these are different type of lineages. We call it lineage 1, 2, 3, but 4, up to 4 they are reported in literature. But recently, 5th lineage has been reported in listeria. And you, maybe, I don't know how many are aware, but these 5th lineage, these are very hyper-virulent strains. Unfortunately, they are also isolated from China. Very, and I think December 2019, the paper has come. 5th lineage of hyper-virulent strains of Listeria monocytogenes, they are reported. And until date, the lineage 1 and 2 pathogens, they are responsible for the outbreak in humans and animals also. These are some of the reports actually, ice cream and other products, particularly food products, cone foods, cheese, caramel apples, ready-to-eat fish. These are all very, very big outbreaks. They have been reported from Europe and even from China and other countries also, foodborne outbreaks. Now, coming to India actually, there is one paper published in Journal of the Association of Physicians of India, 2017. What they say is, listeriosis in adults, truly rare, are rarely diagnosed in India. Our experience says, whosoever has, people say it is not prevalent much, or it is not economically important or publicly important. But whosoever has studied this, they are now convinced that, yes, there are cases of listeriosis in humans also. And it's highly prevalent in foods also. There are so many cases last 3 or 4 years, around more than 25 reports, case reports, they are published. So now this is one paper published from Tiruchirappalli, Tamil Nadu. What the researchers have done, they have collected these samples of milk which is offered as a tirtham in the temples. You know, it is very common in anywhere in India. When you go to temple, they will give some tirtham. So they sampled some milk samples from 10 temples, and they found the Listeria monocytogenes in excess of 100 CFU, all the 10 temples. You see, you can see the papers also in public health, 2013 they are published. So I don't know how many people will be affected are getting some stomach upset, but they ignored about this threat. Then another paper from Banaras Hindu University. So they sampled this biomarker from Ganges, even from milk, from the human. And they found Listeria monocytogenes, which is highly resistant against particularly ampicillin, which is drug of choice for treatment of listeriosis. So this is already emerging, and very few cases, you see the literature again, very few countries they have reported resistance against ampicillin. But now in India, the cases are coming up which are resistant against ampicillin. Our own collection, around, we have found around 4 to 8% of the strains which are resistant against showing the ampicillin, which is the drug of choice. So when we started working under the leadership of Dr. Malik sir on the disease, in I started my work in 1994 at IVRI. So that time it was very much hardly one or two fellows before me. Dr. Bilegaonkar sir, he worked on listeriosis isolates actually, and some work from College of Fisheries, Mangalore, Dr. Karuna Sagar sir and his madam, they were working. They have got training from Germany. So, but other people, they hardly any papers are published paper from India. I can say lack of awareness about listeriosis, lack of awareness about medicos and veterinarians, lack of mandatory notifications, and may not mean the records actually, continuous records also. And when you, we have reviewed the literature, I personally reviewed actually two reviews of ours of 2002, we have published in 2012. So in humans, maternal neonatal listeriosis is the most common clinical cause. And in animals, spontaneous abortions, cervical myocarditis, meningoencephalitis and endometritis, they are the commonest forms reported actually. But if you find the NCDC list, National Center for Disease Control, we don't find listeriosis in that list. So we got two massive funding from Department of Biotechnology. One in 2008, that is Indo-German Consortium for Epidemiology and Comparative Listeria. And in 2012, we got Center of Excellence on Translation Center for Molecular Epidemiology of Listeria monocytogenes. So these are the two fundings we got from Department of Biotechnology. And under these projects actually, four centers were there, IVRI, Nagpur Veterinary College, and IHR Research Complex for Northeast Region, Shillong. And I was working at Goa that time. So we started work, and apart from that, we have several consortium. Even Dr. Nagappa also worked with us, Dr. Madhav Pratap from your Karnataka Veterinary University. He also worked with us. Then so many people from different universities, Bombay Veterinary College and so many colleges, even BHU, Varanasi, even some medical colleges and some other veterinary colleges, they worked with, we have given them some training or type of protocols. So many times worked actually. So what was the brilliance at that time? Now, you know, Listeria monocytogenes is one of the pathogens which is Food Safety and Standards Authority. There are now standards for it. So any product, milk or meat product or fish product, which is to be imported or exported from India, has to be tested by now legal. Even these fish paste in the use for any production of any vaccine, the attest should be free from Listeria monocytogenes, is mandatory also. So then delineating the clonal lineages, we are not knowing what type of pathogens or what type of lineages they have there in India. And then systematic study on pathogenic potential, then diagnostic tools, because hardly only isolation tools were available, and also national report, establishment of national repository. So these are actually things they were asked us by Department of Biotechnology to study and work on this. So now if we just standard sector, just I want to mention, this pathogen, it is a zero tolerance, right? Means any frozen type of mutton, goat, beef, buffalo meat or something, or cheese, should be upset in 25 grams. And as far as the ready-to-feed, ready-to-eat products are there, maybe evaporated milk or sweetened condensed milk or butter, it should be upset in 1 gram. So these are the standards given by Food Safety and Standards Authority of India as per the 2011 regulations. So now coming to these Indian scenario, just I will narrate. So different forms of listeriosis, like poor obstetric history, meningitis, perinatal, then perinephrica, so many types of forms. And recently, multiple cortical brain abscesses, then breast abscesses, and then meningitis, they are reported from our country. Then even now, one of the isolation in one of the hospital, leading hospital in Mumbai, they isolated this one pathogen from the one of the elderly person, bone matter. So he was not responding, having temperature. So they done the biopsy of the person, and they could isolate this organism from bone marrow. So bone marrow carrier state, that is what you can say. Then multiple brain abscesses and meningitis. So many cases, all parts of India, they are reported. This is very recent literature from India. As far as foods are concerned, you will find 1 to 23% beef and goat meat, 2 to 5% poultry meat, up to 35% fresh butter fish, up to 13% and seafood, up to 17% Different researchers they have done, and everywhere they have reported about this is the status in the food in our country. Then we could isolate from migratory sheep, then mastitis, then sheep population reported disorders in bovine. And if you try actually our own work, actually we could isolate this pathogen from mangrove swamps, boa and other areas. We could isolate from the pathogen from mosquitoes. We could isolate this bacteria from caterpillars, house flies also. So because actually this I told is ubiquitous. Even if you sample this actually thrown vegetable waste in the market, I think lot of bacteria, because these caterpillars and mosquitoes are flies, they feed on those garbage or other things. They are likely to transmit mechanically from one place to another. That's why also you get lot of cases of the food poisoning. So these are the sources actually from where we could isolate this bacteria really in high number. So as far as our repository is concerned, now we have more than 1,000 strains. The isolated are almost from 42 sources and from 20 states of India. And this is the only resource we are maintaining. Nobody has this. We are maintaining at our institute, and part of the culture we have already deposited to VTCC, HISA. And many of the things, we are not at Puri culture, but around 500 strains we have characterized by PCR-based serotyping, virulent gene propagation and pulse field. And we have now established one Indian Listeria Cultural Database, Cultural Collection, INCC, unique identifiers we have provided, and we are maintaining those isolates here. Anybody who works at... we have the collections almost from Kashmir to Kerala, almost all the states, we have the culture means, So we did some part of analysis actually, and this paper is published in Nature Group of Journals. In 2016 we published, and we found actually present 4B, serotype 4B clone, which is dominant. Almost 38 authors are listed in this paper. Dr. Nagapal's scores are in this paper. So single pulse type, almost 396 strains we have characterized by pulse field gel hydrogenosis, and also we have whole genome sequencing some. We found a single clone actually, and based on this clone, now we are developing so many types of diagnostics, which is very unique to our country. And within no time, we can diagnose this infection, maybe humans or animals or even in foods also. Then we have almost now our publication, a lot of even different type of foods, other than either antibiotic sensitivity, genetic diversity, virulence potential. We have more than 50 international publications on this pathogen itself, and still it is going on. And fortunately, we got one new species of Listeria when I was working in Goa. So that mangrove swamps, particularly seafood and this soil, you know, these mangroves actually, there will be low tide and high tide. So we have collected samples both during high tide and low tide. We found around 11 isolates, which were actually Listeria, but not identical to those species. When we have characterized in detail, we could found it a new species, Listeria goensis. We have named it after the name of Goa. And you know, this species is not one of the species actually. It is not pathogenic for mice, but it kills the insects. Any type of insects actually, particularly we tested in Galleria melanella model, it is very much pathogenic for them. But mice in a place will do. It is not pathogenic. And it has a very unique property of, it is showing hemolysis, but not exact true hemolysis. We call it hemodization. Like that. So I think I have not put the picture of this actually, but it shows hemodization, very, very, very unique thing. So this is the one species, new species of novel species of Listeria we are recruited from our studies. Now coming to this, our own studies are different protocols actually for isolation, maybe FDA or USDA or ISO. And this FSSAI in India, they have adopted ISO standards, which uses Fraser broth for enrichment and Balkam agar, even aloe agar for this plating, selective media for this isolation of this one. We have developed multi-top MS protocol. I developed in 2008 itself, and we can identify this bacteria within 1 minute using the multi-top. Then we have developed distillation O-based ELISA. You may be aware that this distillation O particularly just shows cross-reaction with streptolysin O and other immunomulysin, perfringolysin. So then in that case, you have to give the proper diagnosis. You have to do adsorption with streptolysin O. But that problem now, we are now, I think, almost solved it. I will discuss that later. Almost we have solved that problem also. And there will be no need to adsorb the samples, serum samples with SLO to get the specific diagnosis of derivative process. So we have developed the latex hybridization test. These are the peptide test. We have developed some synthetic peptides out of the distillation O, which is not showing the cross reactions with distillation O and other cross-reacting bacteria. And this type of protocols, we have standardized also recombinant LR also, and different type of peptides, and they are working very fine actually. And these protocols particularly, we have developed both antibody-based, you can detect antigen also and antibody also. And now these protocols we are modifying for the food establishments. For example, meat or milk, you can do test within 4-5 hours. How this lab can be adapted to protocols also we are working. We also developed LAMP test also for PCR. We also developed multiplex lineage PCR because the serology is very serological, serotyping very costly. So we have developed our in-house lineage. So within no time, within 3-4 hours, if you have any outbreak or something, once get the DNA from the sample, within which lineage of listeria, it is there, that we can tell. Then, we have adapted this lat also for this diagnosis of in caprines and bovines also. And we also tried before absorption, after absorption, because there is no much difference. So this we can do without absorption also, these studies. Then this I was telling about enriched critical food samples. If you get any type of meat sample, just you enrich for 3-4 hours in media. And after centrifugation, if you test that pellet, so you should be able to test this type of bacteria within 3-4 hours. That protocols also we are now standardizing. Then also we developed this multiplex PCR, even serotype grouping PCR. And also we have developed this virulence test also in the form of feed also, that was released by ICR also. So all these protocols in-house we have developed, and anybody wants to work actually this protocol, we are always sharing this, anybody who wants to work on the listeria. Then we also studied on genetic diversity in serotyping, all of the repository we are screening for that also. We have also screened with pulse field generated sources. And this is one slide actually you can see. These are the isolates from Nagpur, from Boa, from Prairie, and from Agra, particularly from milk and milk products. And these were isolated from 2000 to 2008 by different students, different person, no contamination, nothing cross-contamination. When we have done pulse field, if you see the single clone, what we have published, I told earlier also. So, but pulse field also single type of clone we could find in India that is widely prevalent. Then, whatever actually these conclusions from the actually, though it was lesser known, undiagnosed, you can say it's lesser known, undiagnosed, underreported, and no reference laboratory is currently exists for this bacteria. Then lack of simple tests based on immunodiagnostics and limited implementation of robust detection of methods in microbiological laboratories. So, and then also role of Listeria monocytogenes and Listeria evenoi, abortions, about other reported all disorders. And then little information on overall resistance to Listeria in antibiotics and detergents. So these are the areas actually still lacking, and there is a lot of scope to work on this pathogen. Then that what the clone, we have hardly 400 strains out of 1,000 strains we have put screen. And this is very surprising because when we presented this work in the international forums, everybody was surprised because nowhere in the world such type of things. Around 66% of the strains, they are single clone, and which is not isolated by our group only. All different persons, different students, and they isolated and they contributed this strength to our that collection. And this root up and spread of this special temporary distributed stone is also unknown. And there is one MLST type. We have done also multi-sequence typing also, multi-local sequence typing. We found that MLST, this is ST, C28, apparently restricted to India. And invasion is present in different countries, particularly those in East, South Africa. So now we are working those groups, and particularly we are interested actually South African strains, the outbreak was there. And also we are, our database actually, we are also want to screen with these European and American databases also. Let us see what type of, how these strains they are related. So now different type of methods in my medical microbiology, those are students who are listening. We have lot of molecular diagnostics that are available. If you want to do detection, we have frequency PCR, fragment PCR, a different type of particularly if you are the mixed cultures or something, degenerating HPLC or MALDI-TOF. And if you want to, because the molecular epidemiology has its own importance. That's why you need to do MLST, or you can do pulse field, or you can do RAPID PCR also. And if you are doing so much studies, also gene expression profiling, other things also. So these are the tools actually available in medical microbiology. And you may not be having all the things, but in the collaborations with higher laboratories, you can use and you can study any type of foodborne infection. Because earlier, this phenotyping is important. Definitely, we should isolate the bacteria. We should know what type of bacteria. But now our own study, one of my students who is working in Germany now, he has now sequenced almost all the RNAs of Enterobacter. And what the new novel species they have reported, around 40% of the novel species, they are not at least new species are Enterobacter. They are Klebsiella or Serratia or something. So phenotype, those were developed only based on phenotyping. And one or two several difference actually, we can identify this wrongly. So that's why the molecular techniques have come actually. So now even genome sequencing, whole genome sequencing is going to be very cheaper now. Maybe in Europe, hardly €100 or $100 you can have per sequence. In India, also it will come now. So we have to see for actually the advanced techniques to any type of the foodborne infections. And particularly molecular epidemiology, that we are lacking. You see that I have shown you earlier this slide from IDSP. Today morning, Dr. Vilayagankar sir was talking about this food safety issues, another webinar. I don't know how many of you have learned. So he has shown the reports from IDSP. What they say, they have submitted the sample to laboratory, results are awaited. And if you see after 2 years or 3 years also, what type of bacteria was involved in food poisoning, we don't know. That's why the outbreak caused in Assam, some food product. Same outbreak type of is reported in Bihar or Jharkhand. We don't know what type of bacteria they are involved. That's why the molecular epidemiology is very, very important. From where this is grown, what type of bacteria is involved, what type of sequence type is involved. That we are lacking in our country. So that has to be actually strengthened any type of. That's why even these food safety under authority, they are now encouraging these type of studies actually, molecular epidemiology studies or traceability studies like that. So that we'll know how these transmission routes of the different bacteria, maybe in the food, any type of food, they are there actually. So this is one point very, very important. Then now recently this Food Safety and Standard Authority, they have started now different type of network like FoodTech, particularly food safety issues, training center they are starting. And our institute actually is one of the training for trainers also. So we'll be starting some training course on this. And in January 2020, this FSSI has created some NETSCOFAN, that is scientific cooperation, network for scientific cooperation for food safety and applied nutrition. And they form eight groups are there. And there are biological hazard, then foods of animal origin, foods of plant origin, then there are water, other groups are there actually. We got actually the foods of animal origin at Aisha National Research Center on Meat, and we have some 11 laboratories different parts of India. They are working with us on the food safety issues in the foods of animal origin. So I am also part of this project actually, and we are will be working. So now networks are coming in India, and FSI itself, they are promoting such type of network in India so that the food poisoning or the other things they are can be investigated in better manner. Then our activities are concerned. This is one slide I am showing. We got some 186 trainees from Karnataka last year, and this is we are trained by Karnataka State Sheep and Wool Development Corporation. And some they were somewhere 186 unemployed youth. They visited our institute. We have trained them how hygiene meat production particularly. And I came to know told that the government of Karnataka, they have given them one vehicle which are also designed by us, meat on wheels. So that the people in Karnataka, they can get hygienically produced meat and authentic meat, because no lot of adulteration, other things are there. So those people now, I think already one of the vehicle they came to us, and our former vice chancellor, Dr. Suresh Sonopogal sir, he was with us actually to inaugurate such vehicle at our campus. So I think every district, the government of Karnataka has already provided. I think this will go a long way, and I think other states may follow. Even in Telangana, one or two groups they have come forward, and in Siddipet district of Telangana, they have already started such. So purpose is the people now. You know, we have all the 186 people they who came here. We told how to slaughter from slaughtering to making the product. Processed products actually. How the hygiene is important and how the foodborne infections can be prevented. So I think I don't know how many have seen such vehicles flying on the streets of Karnataka. But I think maybe because of COVID or maybe some problem, but they have already been implemented by the government of Karnataka in the state of Karnataka under this Karnataka State Sea Pen Development Corporation. So to come into the private, so as far as the zoonoses are concerned now, maybe foodborne zoonoses or otherwise also are rodent borne, any type of zoonoses, creation of awareness is very, very important. Unless you know how the disease is transmitted or whether there or not. So through interaction with the professionals or highest risk groups or common masses or people engaged in the livestock industry, awareness is must. Unless you know, somebody tells you brucellosis is transmitted from cattle or sheep or goat. But how the farmer actually or the layman people knows about how the disease is transmitted, how I can avoid these things actually, it is maybe not be useful. So this is very important. Then awareness about sanitation and hygiene. This is very important. Unless you take care of the sanitation and hygiene, I think the 50% problem is solved. So that's why motivation, education, reward, recognition, other things are there actually. So this is very important. Even any part of the country, which is particularly meat shop, they slaughter the animal in the morning and they sell up to evening. So what is the quality or the hygiene or this, you can imagine. So such thing actually, the people come to, you have to tell the people that no, if you want to sell the animal, it should be refrigerated or chilled within 3 hours of the slaughter also. Then the people will come forward and they do something. But such things are not yet happening in our country. Then, of course, regulatory front, which FSSAI, they are taking and they are coming with all stringent standards. I am also the one of the scientific panel member in the biological order from the FSSAI. And many of the things, even this Nira and other type of drinks, beverages, everywhere they want microbiological standards or other things. So strict compliance, but there are standards, they are available, but they are strict compliance because they don't have manpower, laboratories. If you want to throughout the country, if you want to sample or something, we don't have such things. So now it must come in future. I think future it will come. And every stakeholder in that actually, they should be aware and of the policies, what are the available and then what are the compliance they have to do. So if they come and maybe it can be done through public or private organization or NGOs, they have to be involved actually. Then only such things will come further. But of course, now we are talking of the One Health. Tomorrow also I have another talk, another group actually on webinar. So of course, only veterinarians or only medicos or only food inspectors or only animal welfare officers, they cannot help. So we should have actually people from even social now, particularly antimicrobial resistance, other things are coming. We should have the social scientists, anthropologists, which are the groups they are more, you have to tell them that such if you are doing these activities are so. So how these different type of foodborne infections or zoonoses, they are being transmitted. So we have to promote these humans, animals, and environment health, that we call it truly one health. And then I think we can going to have these infections away from our society. So I want to acknowledge my professor from Germany for this history of work, because of him actually we could do lot of things, lot of techniques he has given to us. Our director from Harvard, then my mentor Dr. Malik sir, because no, always we talk. I think after doing our MSc or PhD, many of the students they may not have contact also. But there is no day that I talk to Dr. Malik sir every day almost. And my colleague Dr. D.B. Rao, D.B. Rao, he teach me also. My student students of course, but also what he has done at maximum. And then Department of Biotechnology, we are funded, and Ministry of Science and Technology, German government, they also given funding, lot of funding to work on this area particularly. So I thank you for your kind attention. If you have any questions, I will be happy to answer. This is my contact email ID. Anybody wants to, even if you can see our website also, we have lot of. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for wonderful presentation. With respect to Dr. Barbude, sir, his team was the first to elucidate the role of mosquito as a carrier of listeriosis. His work on Listeria goanensis has been highlighted by him. He is the person who instrumentally contributed for ILCC, Indian Listeria type cultures. And he has handled about 41 projects, of which about 8 extramural and 1 international. Majority of them are revolving around the listeriosis. He is a panel member of FSSI on biological hazards, and he is active member of the ISOPOL. And he has also been conferred with the fellow of Indian IAVPHS and many more fellowships. So with this, now the topic is open for discussion. Before we can proceed, it is our privilege to receive in the Dr. S.P.S. Malik sir, who is a source of inspiration to us. It's an honor to sir to see you in the this room. We have Tumati Srinivas Rao sir, Deepak Rahul sir, Sujata madam, Bindu Kiranmayi, Manjunath sir, and all are there. With this, let me start the first question. Mr. Rakesh, you can ask the question. Rakesh, the question of Rakesh is, I think, is not available, sir. So his question was related to the vector control region.
Nagappa sir, please, you only ask the question and answer, sir. Audience should not be given answer, okay?
Okay, that's good, I think. Sir, on behalf of audience, let me ask the question. Rakesh Patra has asked the question, sir, role of vector control in the management of foodborne zoonosis. Probably this is what I perceive the question.
Yes, vector actually particularly, you know, flies and house flies particularly. It's one of the vector actually where actually this foodborne transmission actually is much, much common. Actually, you can see everywhere in restaurants are everywhere actually. So this is one of the leading transmitter, maybe mechanical or through other means also. So definitely it has a major role. Vector control is a major role in the transmission of foodborne zoonosis. Definitely.
Thank you, sir. The next question was asked by Shashank. It is related to the Listeria form. Septicemic form is seen in monogastrics, while neurological form is seen in ruminants. So can you just elaborate on this?
Yeah, actually, now, as far as the literature is concerned, they are, but nothing, even monogastrics, they find actually meningitis and other forms also. But even actually ruminant, and you know, actually, one of the pathogen, actually, this is Listeria ivanoi. We call it actually more common in the ruminant. Right. So why it is not much common in humans and common in the ruminants? So now the whole genome sequencing of this Ivanova has found that this is capsulated. It has capsule, particularly this Listeria Ivanova, not monocytogenous. So that may be the reason actually, because this rumination and because this animals actually ruminant particularly, it may be infecting the pellets, everything. That's why the type of form of distribution due to even why is more common in the ruminants. And other rumen encephalitis and other type of forms is very, very common in the ruminants. And as far as the mono humans are very concerned actually, we found septicemia because, you know, any type of food we are taking, contaminated food. Immediately it will be actually bacteria will go from the intestinal barrier to the blood-brain barrier in the blood, and immediately there will be temperature, right? So high temperature, then it will show septicemic symptoms. So that may be the reason actually because of high foodborne that transmission of this bacteria.
Thank you, sir. Pushkarji has asked one question. The media to be used for isolation of listeria from CSF, cerebrospinal fluid.
Yeah, actually see, CSF is always, if you are collecting this CSF in particularly in sterile conditions. So what we are having protocols from isolation from food, like enrichment in fajar broth and palka magar. So if you are having sterile, maybe the meconium from the newborn or the CSF, you can directly streak on blood agar also. Okay, but you have to see that if the patient is on the antibiotic treatment already, so in such cases, you have to do resuscitation. So you can put the CSF in 0.7% extract broth. Then later you have to do, because there will be no much contamination. You can go directly streaking on the blood agar itself, or even palka magar. Palka magar having some inhibitory bit, but even blood agar can help you to isolate. Otherwise, any type of contaminated samples, if you find some milk or other things, you have to do some enrichment, because you have to, this background flora, particularly gram-negative bacteria, you have to get rid of. But if the sample is sterile, maybe blood, direct blood, collect culture, or CSF culture, or material from the newborn, this abortions or stillbirth, you can directly streak on the blood agar also, you will get colonies directly.
Okay. Thank you, sir. The next question is by Dr. Malinath. He has asked, is there any vaccine for listeriosis in humans or animals?
No. Actually, at present, many people are there trying, but nobody has succeeded to have this vaccine, even for the animals also or for humans also. So at present, you cannot, there is no commercial vaccine available for against listeriosis in animals or humans.
Okay, sir. The next question has been asked by Manasa. It is on, is pasteurized milk involved in the listeria transmission? If at all it is involved, at what level it is?
Yes. Now, pasteurization is supposed to kill this bacteria, Listeria monocytogenes. But if there is faulty pasteurization or there is post-pasteurization contamination, there are chances and there are reports and outbreaks which are caused due to this pasteurized milk. Even I will tell over my own experience, we could isolate more listeria from pasteurized milk than raw milk. You know what is the reason? Because in pasteurized milk, there's a spinous flora we are taking out. But if you are not heating the milk properly up to the point, actually, this bacteria will grow and only listeria will grow. So this was my experience. Actually, whenever we have tested the pasteurized milk, we got more listeria than the raw milk. So pasteurized milk, if you are not done properly, definitely it can transmit listeria. And there are reports, obvious reports, and also outbreaks also because of even many type of the cheese, raw cheese and also pasteurized cheese, even ready to eat milk products, they are implemented in the foodborne outbreaks because of listeria monocytogenes.
Thank you, sir. Are there any other questions? This is what we could see in the chat box. Okay. If there are no doubts, there is one big.
Yes, hello, Dr. Sujata Singh, sir.
Yes, ma'am, please. Go ahead, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir. Sir, just I want to ask about anything you have done research on listeriolysin, sir.
Yes. Actually, my main work is on listeriolysin O itself. Right from my PhD until that, we are working on listeriolysin O because that is the antigen which is highly immunogenic, and all the diagnostics which are developed maybe based on these actually molecular studies or serological studies, they revolve around HLYN, which is the gene for listeriosis encoded by this listeriosis O. And we are also working on the synthetic peptides from listeriosis O itself. So already we are working on it now also. And this is one of the factors. Even actually somebody tried on vaccines also earlier. They were actually some against using listeriosis O. This is a highly immunogenic protein from the listeriosis monocytogenes.
Yes.
So we are already, yes, we are working, still working on it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you, sir. Now the questions from the YouTube stream. Now there is a compliment from Malik, sir. Thank you, sir. If you can read Barbada, sir, that's great. And there are some more questions, sir. Can you just see and answer them, sir? Or shall I? Abdul, you can take those questions.
Yes,
Yes, sir. Okay. Sir, is my voice is audible?
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, sir. These are the questions from YouTube. Gaurav Basak is asking, can Listeria serve as an indicator organism for other organisms? Or presence of Listeria means there will be other organisms like coliform is known as indicator organism.
Yeah, actually see, particularly for Listeria infection, Listeria ignacua is taken as Listeria ignacua, which is bacteria, actually it is taken as an indicator for the bacteria. It is null pathogenic bacteria. And as far as actually, because you know, different physical indicators are different, but food actually, when you are detecting any type of Listeria ignacua, is taken as a actually indicator for Listeria monocytogenes. So, in the Listeria monocytogenes may be present in there.
Okay, sir. Dr. Biswaj Datta is asking, among the animals, which species is mostly affected with Listeria?
Actually, in India, all types, even we could find this actually in sheep. What's more, actually, if you see the literature, the sheep farms in Kashmir and Himachal Pradesh, more than 20% of abortions they are attributed to only Listeria only. Then also goat, actually in plains also we found some outbreaks in goats also. Even you have found these reproductive disorders in buffaloes and cattle because of Listeria. Even subclinical mastitis in Listeria. So you cannot say there one species you can find out. Even there is one outbreak in Hyderabad in 2000 reported from broiler Listeria monocytogenes. And there are two or three reports, massive up to 70% mortality in pigs. This Listeria monocytogenes. These are all published reports I am telling from India. So there is no species actually, even sheep, goat, buffaloes, then pigs, I mean poultry. Outbreaks of Listeria have been reported in India.
Okay, sir. Last question, Neil. Is Listeria can transmit to drinking water?
Yes.
Like waterborne disease, waterborne zoonosis?
Yes. Listeria can transmit through contaminated water, definitely. It is a contagious. It can transmit.
Okay, sir. Nagappa, sir, take over.
There is one basic question that, sir, can the many of the students, they are asking, can they get the PDF form of this presentation? For their information, one thing is they can directly contact the presenter, Barbude sir. And second thing is that everything is recorded in the YouTube.
Yeah.
Please visit the site. The entire lecture will be there along with the presentation that you can make your own notes. Then one more basic problem that is asked is, you know that there is in the Google Meet, there are only 100 participants that can be accommodated. Remaining some 300 to 400 will be there in YouTube streaming. So in case you don't get into the Google Meet, you please enter the live streaming. So with this, it is a time to thank our invited guest today, Dr. Dilip Kumar sir, who spared his valuable time. And he addressed the participants. We have participants of across the country. And secondly, we are very much honored and privileged to have with us the eminent speaker, the WHO expert, and almost an authority on listeriosis, Dr. S.P. Barbude, for enlightening us and for clearing the many of the doubts of the young minds. Then we have the Alumni Association of Hassan Veterinary College, who have taken a lot of pains to organize this event. So on behalf of the organizers, we thank them. And second, the faculty members of Hassan Veterinary College and all the persons who have participated, so we thank them. And the last but not the least is the man behind this mission, that is Zoonosis Week, is our Dean, Dr. M.C. Shivakumar sir. It is his brainchild that we could organize this event of such kind and to celebrate the World Zoonosis Day in a meaningful way. So we have tomorrow the Kashmir Forest Disease. We have again one more authority on KFD. So he's going to speak about. So I request all the participants to get into the system as early as possible. Thank you, one and all. Abdul?
Hello.
Yeah. Thank you, Abdul.
Hello, Dr. Nagappa.
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for your valuable time.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, doctor.
Hello.
Thank you, sir.
End kodla. Stop. Stop. Streaming kodla.
Thank you.
Thank you.
YouTube वाला इल्ली जाए हाँ ओके